Hey, everybody, before we get started, we have a very important and probably sad announcement for about five of you.
Yeah, at least somebody.
Johnny B, maybe. maybe Bert.
They'll both be torn up, yeah.
Maybe Jason Passon's out there. But sad for everybody, I think, on this side of the microphone.
Is that your side?
On this side of the ears.
Yeah.
Maybe it's not sad for you, but this is our last episode. And we didn't, when we recorded, we didn't plan it this way. But it kind of has evolved in the last couple of days to where this will be the last episode.
Yeah, we've just done some assessments and
soul searching, you might say.
Yeah, just kind of discussed our overall place in this beer world and what we've done with the show and where it could go. And a lot of ways, I think we've done a lot of what I really have wanted to do with the show. I think we met a lot of nice people, some awesome people. I realize there's a really awesome craft brew scene here. Shared that with folks that have dared to listen to us. And we really appreciate the time and effort from anybody we've ever interviewed, anybody that's been on, you know, Javi, whoever else has been regular.
Yeah.
And, yeah, we really do appreciate that. But it's just kind of come to a point where I think we're starting to kind of recycle. It's starting to kind of fall into, you know, lazier habits because it's easy. And kind of a commitment more than being just kind of the full-blown, passionate project it was when we first came out of the gate.
Yeah, I think when we started the show, we wanted to be different. And I think we were, in a lot of respects. For better or for worse, we were different than a lot of beer review shows out there. Strictly beer. I mean, there's a lot of beer and shows. Beer and boards, or beer and political talk, or whatever. So, for a pure beer show, I think we had a lot of goals. And like you said, I think we met a lot of those goals. I think we were different than a lot of shows out there. And, I think that our lives have changed so much in the last 3 years. Cause I think we've been doing this almost 3 years.
Yeah. 2015.
Things have changed a lot in the beer scene. Have changed a lot with us. And I think for us, it just kind of felt, we just realized in the last 2 days that it's a natural conclusion for us on this show. And it's for many reasons. Like for me, as my interest in becoming more healthy in the last year, it's been a year this June that I kind of started a new path in life. As my interest in becoming more healthy and losing weight and getting into martial arts again, I mean, my interest in craft beer has waned. And it's not that I don't like craft beer. I still love it, but I don't drink as much. And as a result, I don't keep up with the news as much. And as a result, I don't go to events as much. You know, it's like a compounding thing.
And, you know, we have to be that involved. We have to be into all of that to have a good show that was the basis for the premise of this show.
Right.
And, I'm the same way. I need to get healthier and need to stay focused on that. And it's hard to get up a lot of excitement for doing a lot of these events these days. Mm-hmm. And it's nothing against those events. They're fun. And I'd still like to do some of those sometimes. I definitely will. You know, it's not those of you that know us, the very few that do and are out there, you will still see us at events on occasion for sure. It just won't be in the podcast interview variety. I think it'll also kind of allow the times we do dip into the craft beer scene to be more just entertainment, kind of like it was before we started the show, and doesn't have to be so analytical. And we don't have to think about, what's the content for the next episode? When do we have to edit the next episode?
Yeah.
There's a lot of work if you haven't done a podcast, going to promotion and editing and
there is
construction.
There is if you're audio file nerds like we are, that we want to, there are some shows that don't necessarily worry about production value. They just put something out there. And you know, for me, if I'm putting out a project, I want it to be as good as we can make it audio wise. Cause it drives me up the wall if I don't put my best foot forward. And I think this is part of why it's becoming it's a natural conclusion too, is because I don't feel like I have been putting my best foot forward in with respect to this show, because it's not that I don't want to go to the events, it's that I don't want to go to an event where it's obligatory drinking all the time. And if we're really going to get out there and hustle and make this the best event it's going to be, those things happen weekly around here. I mean, there's craft beer events all the time, and that would mean we're out drinking multiple beers at least once a week. And that's not something I have an interest in doing at this point in my life. And to me, and then turn around, and then that kind of just shapes itself into that I'm not putting out I'm not putting my best foot forward in podcasting. And that's a disservice to the people who listen to this show.
Right.
And so it's just kind of like this, it's a it's been a thing that's been evolving over time, and I think it just kind of broke through for both of us in the last couple days.
Yep, I would agree. I think that pretty much sums it up, really.
So we definitely appreciate everybody who ever listened to the show, everybody who emailed us regularly and all that. We appreciate all of you. It's been a great 3 years.
People who have sent us beer will still drink it, even though yes. we won't be reviewing it on the show.
Yes, so we'll still drink it. We'll still check into Untappd and all that. And you might find us popping up on other beer shows once in a while. Stefan, he'll be here. He's been on the show before. He'll be here in the next couple of weeks, and I'll be on that show. And, you know, we'll tweet out that stuff when it comes along if you have an interest in listening.
Sure.
And, you know, we probably have another project coming down the pipe pretty soon. And if you want to keep listening to us, we'll still be here in audio form.
The personality wise, but yes. If you only came for the content,
if you only came for the beer, that probably won't be here much anymore.
Right.
So this is going to be a more media focused podcast, pop culture. So sure. If you like pop culture, if you like watching things, if you like viewing things with your eyes or just listening to them, but not looking at them,
right.
Like you do this show, then this might be a show for you.
You know, you stare at your phone and watch right. the seconds go by,
yeah.
which you can, I guess, yes. but it's a little odd.
So we'll definitely, you know, as we figure things out on that project front, we've got a good concept in mind. We'll put out a trailer. We'll let you know where you can find it. We may just replace this feed with that new show. You don't know. But I would encourage you, if you like the show and if for some reason you want to listen to old episodes, I would say if we're going to take down the feed and go to a new feed for the new show, this is your chance. Yeah, so you get about a month to download all the episodes. Otherwise, they might disappear forever at that point.
They might be on the Wayback Machine or something. I don't know.
Yeah, we might be able to upload them to archive.org or something.
Right.
If that's without minus all the show notes, because I'm not going to take the time to do 150 plus episodes of show notes one sure. at a time. I have no desire to do that. But if you want to download them, then by all means, have at it. You know, download all you can. Because they will probably go away at some point. And if we pursue this new project, then this feed will probably be replaced with that new one. But say stick around. You might enjoy the new project. It's a bit of a retro show, a retro concept, and involves TV probably. So I hope everybody will enjoy it as long as it gets off the ground.
Right.
So for Dustin and Mark.
For Mark, I'm Dustin. Enjoy the last episode.
You're listening to the Screaming Pods Network.
Drink beer. Think beer. You're listening to BrewBlood.
Drink beer, think beer, right?
That's right. Drink beer and think beer. And today we're going to get a little, I hope not depressing, but we've got a kind of a themed episode, and it's just happenstance. It wasn't planned this way.
I'm already crying a little bit.
Yeah, we're going to cry. We're going to shed some yeah. tears. We're going to go through therapy together. But it just kind of happened to fall this way that yeah. a big... Well, we're going to be talking about BrewDog's Nanny State, if you can't tell by the episode title. And Nanny State is a low ABV beer. And we had this shipped in Kit's butt again.
Yeah.
All the way from Sweden.
He shipped his beer up here, yes.
As far as I know, we can't get it in the United States.
No, we can't. I've looked for it.
Yeah, as far as I know. But there was also, in the last couple of weeks, the owner of Hill Farmstead they're in Vermont, Sean Hill. So he was over in Europe. He was a keynote speaker at a conference, and he sat down with a journalist, and they were talking to him about a variety of things, his career, how
generic,
he started with
yes. yeah,
Hill Farmstead, things like that.
Yeah.
And the interesting thing to come out of this article was, as the title of this article on the Morning Advertiser says, which is such a generic name, the beer industry not discussing mental health and alcohol link. And the whole article talks about Sean Hill's position on drinking and how in the craft beer industry we should be more responsible for talking about the link between mental issues and drinking. And, you know, we talked last week about CBD and
right.
how it's helped both of us with stress relief, anxiety, things like
right.
that. And I think this is kind of a similar thing that we've both talked about a lot of times, because he's not just talking about someone who has like bipolar disorder or something like
right.
that. He's speaking more to, interestingly, how we use beer as a crutch or alcohol as a crutch. And it's something that that we're not talking about in the beer industry. And frankly,
that is so common in society.
It is. And it's, I can't say I blame breweries for not discussing it, because
sure.
it is.
That kind of kills their brand.
Yes. Their whole reason for existing is for you mm-hmm. to drink and imbibe. But it's an interesting position to take. So he says about anxiety and you know, problems with alcohol. He says, or mental health, I should say, not alcohol. He says, I don't know anyone in the beer world who isn't struggling with it. Look at every photo from festivals like Michelob Beer Celebration, where the guys from Steph and Mike and his partner, they were just at that. He said, people are drinking 10 glasses of beer every day and living this wild traveling lifestyle. It really isn't healthy. And then he continues. He said, talks about how when his brew is first starting to explode, when they became the number one brewery, according to Rate Beer, in the world. He said, I don't really remember much of 2014 through 2016. Those years are complete black holes to me. If I met you during the time, I wouldn't remember. He said, imagine brewing 4 to 5 days a week, managing 15,000 square foot build out, while also trying to keep your girlfriend, staff, and customers happy. It was too much. My mental health at that time was probably shit. I was doing 12 to 14 hour days, and because I lived 15 feet away from the brewery, there was very little decompression. I would typically drink too much in order to decompress, and then I wouldn't sleep well. Then when I woke up, I would still be tired, so then I would drink as much caffeine as I could, which would then accelerate an overall sense of anxiety. It was a vicious circle. I felt like shutting in the brewery every single day, but at the same time, you need that darkness to define your success or have something to aspire to. It is only in relation to that time in my life that you then come to understand and put yourself in a better position, or understand yourself and put yourself in a better position, I should say. So that's the first part. There's three parts to this article I think are kind of interesting. But that first part, I think you and I can both relate to. We've had, you know, I would say our ups and downs with drinking. You know, I'm in a period of my life where, just for health's sake, trying to lose weight, I don't drink as much. You know, pretty much the only time I drink beer right now is when we're doing the show.
Yeah.
And...
yeah, me too.
Maybe that's gives me a lack of credibility in some people's eyes. I have found that I don't suffer from the depressive effects of alcohol, which people don't talk about, especially coming off of drinking too much, the depressive qualities of that. You know, those things I don't miss. I love beer. I love the taste of beer. I love all the variety that's in beer. But there are a number of negative effects of that, which is not just weight, which I'm trying to get down, but also the mental health issues in that.
And there's a lot around that, too. I mean, you're talking about not even just depression, but, you know, liver health, body health in general, caloric intake.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's got all the negatives, for sure. I mean, technically, alcohol, you know, is a poison that your body's trying to push out of you.
Right.
As much as, you know, we like to have a kick-ass time where we're consuming it, that's definitely just a fact.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, on top of that, you know, it alters your state. It makes you think things or, you know, act ways that you don't normally. And it has a fun element, but it also has a very negative element at a certain point, especially if you're getting to the point where this guy's talking about, where if you're drinking daily and then you're also having to counter out, you know, you're drinking with caffeine and all that kind of stuff. I mean, that's a bad level to be at.
I've been there.
Yeah.
I mean, like... between sometimes at the work, like there was a long time where I was drinking every night.
See, I've never quite gone that far. I've had down periods, which right now I'm in one. I'm only drinking today because we're doing this for the show. I'm kind of in a dry period. But yeah, I've never had a daily. I definitely haven't had that. But even the periods like over the holidays or something where I drink like a bunch.
Yeah.
You know, when you come out of that, sometimes you're kind of like, man, that. I feel better when I don't do that all the time instead of doing it constantly. You know, I mean, yeah, it's real kick ass and cool, but to do it like, oh yeah, I drink every day. It's awesome. Mm-hmm. I go drink all these different beers. Like, but yeah, you know, there's times where maybe you just take a break and you'll end up feeling better.
Yeah, I agree. Like I felt up until I had a hospital scare a couple weeks ago. You know, I was in the hospital for a couple of days. You know, I felt great, and I haven't.
That's from prolapsed anus, though. Yeah, I mean, that's a different thing.
It had nothing to do with my drinking.
Yeah, it's just your sexual activity.
Yeah, it's just my sexual proclivities.
Yeah,
but I felt great. Like, you know, I've been working out a lot more, and I think I've been a more healthy individual. And I think it's something that should be talked about. There's many times when I've
just find a at the mark / workout. You know?
That's right. But no, like
you can watch all those workouts.
But I've gone months where I would drink every day.
No.
And usually it was whiskey, not beer. Like I would drink beer. Some days I would mix them. I would combine them. You know, beer and whiskey.
And you tend to have the idea that whiskey is maybe better because it has less calories or whatever. But still, the alcohol effect on the body. You know, it's pretty much similar.
I'm lucky / cursed in that I don't typically get a hangover.
Yeah,
I have to drink a lot to get a hangover. So there's not.
I think
usually,
we're kind of in that same boat. I very rarely get hangovers too.
Yeah, there's
our wives are not in that boat.
No,
you and I are.
I know.
We're pretty lucky on that front.
Like I said, it's good slash a curse because it's also like I don't have that mental check the next morning and be like, oh, other than the stupid shit I've done.
Yeah.
When I've been drunk, I don't have that mental check or that check, that physical check, other than sometimes resulting depression.
Right.
But it's also it's you have to realize at some point you have to address your own problems.
You know, for me though, the depression side really comes out a lot because I don't remember what I did, and if I do hear what I did and it was stupid, then I'm depressed about the fact that I did that. You know, it's kind of like, oh man, I can't believe you did that dumb shit while you were, you drank that much. But you know, and I'm sure everybody listening to this podcast understands that because I feel like craft beer. It's a joke in the industry to say, you know, oh, it's cool we have this, you know, craft beer realm because it makes my drinking problem seem like a fun hobby or whatever.
Right.
There's a lot of memes around that and stuff. But at the same time, like, I think everybody we know, I'm not going to call anybody's names out, obviously, but almost everybody we know has taken a break at some point because they have been over-consuming too much and they need to, like, dial it back.
Yeah, and reset.
And, I mean, is that a good thing? I don't know. I mean, I don't think craft beer in a lot of ways is really any different than people who, you know, drink a lot of whiskey and drink a lot of vodka and drink a lot of bourbon or whatever. I think it's all kind of the same in a lot of ways.
It is. I think it's good that at least the people we know, like, it's good to acknowledge that you've been doing too much and you need to
reset. I agree with that, yes.
That's you're being aware of yourself.
Right.
I also had, a stepfather who was a complete alcoholic and didn't acknowledge that he had a problem. That was even worse. But
sure,
at least people can recognize the problems. That's great. You just have to realize you have to get at your core issues. And
right.
You can't. Alcohol is just a temporary salve for that. It's not going to fix your problems.
It's a dopamine pump.
Right.
And makes you happy at the time. And you get in that habit of getting that dopamine hit. And then that's what happens. You know, it's very easy to get in that realm. You know,
it
just
is.
Do that over and over again.
It is. And I mean, I'll do it a few times a year. It's just.
Nope.
It sucks. But for the last year, I've been really good about avoiding that.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm down 90 pounds as of yesterday. You know, like, it's good. I've gotten out of the habit. And there are days I miss it. There are days I miss, like, there are many days I wish I was like, God, I wish I could just have a beer right now. You know, I'm not going to because I got specific goals, you know?
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah. I wish it wasn't an issue, but
it does
happen. Yeah,
yeah, but unfortunately, I let myself get out of control one too many times, and I have to learn the lesson. I have to find I'm trying to find a new balance. Right now, my balance is don't drink most of the time. Right now, it's only drink when I'm doing the show most of the time.
And it's worse for some people. Like, you know, I got family issues. I don't know if you have that too. But, you know, you got to also pay more attention for the fact that you have that going on.
Yeah, I've got alcoholism in my family.
Yeah,
for sure.
So, you know, you got to worry about that. Yeah. And you got to make sure you're not falling into that trap. But that's not to say don't drink beer, don't have fun.
No.
But it is also to recognize that as much as our American culture like pushes every social situation, everything has to be like, oh, you go here and you have this drink, you go here and have that drink. Like, it's kind of okay to go to some places and be like, I'm not going to drink this place. I'm not going to drink at that place. You can have just as much fun. Like, I've been doing that this last month before this episode. Obviously, drink today some for this show. But, yeah, I've gone to several different things and not had a drink, and you know, actually it's been perfectly fine and I've enjoyed it. It's been fun. Like, you don't have to have alcohol to have fun, and
you don't.
I just feel like our society in America, especially, maybe Europe's the same way, I can't confirm that because, you know, that's all the way over there. That's
right.
That's like a way away thing.
Basically just doesn't
but
exist.
Yeah, it's like, you know, who cares about that? That's over there. But here it's a big thing,
right?
You know, every happy hour, go hang out with a friend, go grab a beer and hang out with a friend. Like, that's what you do. It's
they've
like,
got pub culture over there. I mean, they.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you know. I know. I'm just being stupid on that. But I'm just saying that here, like, it's very common to be like, oh, I haven't seen you a while. You want to go grab a beer and hang out? Like, you can't just go, let's go grab some, I don't know, extreme fajitas and hang out or something. Like, I don't know. You could do something else, but just don't do that much here.
I mean, I have often thought about this, like, you know, when we used to hang out back in the day and we weren't drinking, like in high school.
Right.
You know, and even in my college days, like, I didn't touch any alcohol until I was 24.
Yeah.
Like, I maybe had a beer or something like that, but it was never a habit. Like, I never drank
You're right. I had some when I was younger, 24. But it wasn't like a constant for sure.
I had
like some MGD or something when I was younger, but it wasn't much.
But I didn't like ever. I'd never been drunk until I was 24.
Yeah.
And then I had tequila, and it was all downhill from there. But it's interesting how things have changed. Like, we used to hang out all the time without drinking, and
all through middle and high school,
early college. It's just weird how those things shift. And the great thing about alcohol is it does lower inhibitions. I think it makes social situations easier to deal with. There's no doubt about that.
It can.
And once you get used to that feeling of loosening up under the effects of alcohol, it is so easy because it just makes going to things that parties and stuff where you may not know people. It makes it that much easier.
It definitely can, but at the same time, if you don't use it as a crutch and try it, then you can also find out that just your normal, natural personality can perfectly get through this situation, too.
Yeah.
Like, there's an initial concern of, I got to have some drinks to, like, feel good. But if you go into it for, like, you know, hour, 2 hours, and then you'll realize, like, I'm perfectly fine. I don't need this.
Yeah,
it's kind of it's a crutch going into the situation and prepping for the situation because you know you will have alcohol to go into it.
Yeah.
It definitely helps, yes.
Yeah, and if you're like me, where you're kind of an extrovert, introvert, and like there's plenty of times where I don't want to be around people, I will. Like, it helps.
Me too. You and I are very similar on that front.
It just sucks when you have to be social and you don't want to be. That's where alcohol really helps me.
Well, like last night, I have a friend that lives across the alley, and if I was drinking, I probably would have gone over there and hung out. And last night, I was like, I'm not, and I really don't want to.
Yeah.
I probably should push myself into those situations, and we did that day.
We
went over there earlier without alcohol, but at the same time, it's kind of like, I know what you mean, but it's dangerous to rely on alcohol as the reason to be able to be social and to go to events. Like, you need to be able to do it without it, which all this probably sounds really weird being on a beer podcast,
but
I think it's a very important thing to address in the industry, though.
Well,
we don't get on the soapbox much on the show, but I think this is a very important thing. There's like a very good example is a local radio show here. There's somebody that used to drink a lot that does not. You and I listen to a lot. Mm. And somebody mentioned on there talking about it seems really weird that all these bars, you know, some of them have serving limits, some of them don't, but they all have giant parking lots. Yeah. But we're all against drunk driving, but we're also all okay to say, let's go to the bar and have some drinks and then drive home. Like, it seems kind of weird on like a societal acceptance level, like, you know, and then at the same time, we're living in a state that is very anti, you know, marijuana, gambling, all these other vices. Like, we're anti all these vices except the one that's been grandfathered in that we're okay with dealing with all the time.
Right.
And people are okay with driving around and we'll just have like drunk driving issues and stuff. I don't know. It's a really weird, convoluted.
It's an interesting contradiction.
Situation. Yeah. Yes. In my opinion. Yes.
I agree. I mean, I think that's where Europe has it right in a lot of situations is that they are much tougher about drinking and driving than we are in the States.
We should be tough here.
Like, we should be. We should be.
And you and I think we can both admit we've both been drunk drivers in the past. And we probably should have got our asses handed to us.
Absolutely.
Right? I mean, it's a bad thing.
Honestly, like, I should have had multiple DUIs.
Yeah, me too. I'm not begging for it, but
thank, you know, the great spaghetti monster in the sky that I never got a DUI. Like,
me too, yeah.
I deserve multiple ones.
Yeah.
I do too. I probably should have been in jail, you know, for the amount of and I look back on it and I was like, wow, like, you're an idiot.
Yeah.
Part of it is the youthful indiscretion, and that's not an excuse. It's just sometimes you feel, and alcohol contributes to the feeling of being invincible, especially when you're younger, you feel even more invincible about that.
Absolutely.
About anything in the world. And I chalk it up to stupidity, and I'm very thankful I didn't go to jail because I should have been. I should have been in jail multiple times.
At least half a dozen times minimum, maybe more. I should have been jailed, for sure.
It's all part of the maturing process, and now I'm at a point where I'm trying to find... I've had mental issues my entire life, like social, like dealing with family and all that. You know, it's just another phase of my evolution.
Sure.
I don't know that I'll ever have it all figured out. I'm just trying to find new ways to cope with going to
who has it all figured out? I don't know.
Yeah, I know. But I'm trying to find new ways to live without coping with alcohol all the time.
Right.
Because it's easy, and it's a fun easy, but it's too easy, and it's terrible for you.
Yeah.
When you drink to excess. It's good on a limited scale, terrible to excess, like many things. Everything in moderation.
Well, like I said, we don't like to get on the soapbox much here, but I think this is a very important thing to address with people that drink beer.
Yeah.
Or any alcohol. I'm assuming most people that listen to this podcast probably don't just drink craft beer. They probably also drink other alcohols.
Yeah.
And it's just kind of an important topic in general.
It is. I think it's something you should constantly be evaluating your life.
Absolutely, yes.
So I did want to talk about one more thing. Well, two more things in respect to this. So one other thing he commented about, Sean, from Hill Farmstead or Farm... I can't remember the name of this. Because we don't get their beer here, so...
Yeah.
I mean, I'm aware of them, but Hill Farmstead. I said that right. I know they're highly rated. We've never had any of their beer, and we don't get it here. But yeah. As part of this interview, he said he also expressed his concern at the rise of the internet and subsequent decline of pubs, changing with the way in which drinkers communicate, warning of psychological, physical, and societal consequences of a lack of interaction with another. I mean, he's not wrong. He basically said, quote, if you think about what is responsible for people failing to communicate with each other face to face, it's the internet and the different mode of communication it has given rise to.
Right.
The way in which people interact with each other is drastically changing, and even the way in which we interact with beer is changing. And this is kind of ironic since we're on a beer criticism show here, but he says, I know a lot of people who are highly critical of almost every single beer and never switch off. If you look at apps like Untappd, you have people rating every single beer they drink. Just put the fucking phone down and let's talk about something that is not in relation to the beer we're drinking.
Right.
And this, you know, this is a direct relation to this show because for a long time we went without reviewing beers.
Yeah.
And.
Well, even now our reviews aren't really intense.
They're not like they used to be.
Yeah.
I mean, we get a little picky, but we're not like, it's not like it was. Like, we were much more serious before. Not to say we don't have legitimate criticisms about the beer we're talking about. But he's right. Like, you can't, and this is why we got away from it in the beginning, is because I was getting tired of being critical of.
Yeah.
I was over-criticizing. And it's finding,
kind of the same thing when we used to review movies.
Yeah,
you know,
you find flaws. I stopped enjoying movies for a long time as a result of that because I was always just picking apart the flaws.
Yep.
Not that I still don't have my criticisms.
Sure, yeah. Well, we're all movies. Humans with brains, so it happens, yeah.
Like, I just recently watched my first Tyler Perry movie, and boy, was that a disaster.
Yeah. Holly Perry.
Did I say Holly Perry?
Yeah.
I meant Tyler Perry.
Okay.
Yeah, Confessions of a Marriage Counselor is a garbage movie.
No,
but anyway,
most of those are, yes.
It's easy to be critical, and I think one thing we found out post-2016 election is we have given rise to this hyperbolic culture the ease with which we have to blast our opinions to the world is not a good thing.
Right.
I've gotten to the point now where I have receded from most of social media.
Yeah, me too.
And
other than the show,
like I have a Twitter account. I rarely post anymore.
Yeah,
and I found myself.
It's only like nudes. That's pretty much it.
Yeah, I only put out dick pics.
Yeah,
just the tip.
Right.
And no shaft included.
Just sitting on the camera. One of the two. Yeah.
I don't tweet much anymore. Yeah. I when I go back through my own tweets, I'm like. And I've deleted a bunch of them. And you're free to go out there and see my stupid opinions about things. But like, I don't get out there and criticize anymore.
I'm going to take you down with your former tweets. That's what I'm going to do.
Maybe I should go lock my account. but I find myself writing critical tweets.
Yeah.
And then I delete them. I'm like, this is exactly the person I don't want to be. I don't want to be that person anymore. I want to have a. Not to say that there are things I'm not enraged about in culture, politically speaking, especially. I am, but I can't. So many people are sustaining themselves on criticism and rage to a hyperbolic point that it has just it's made me sick, and I'm tired of it. I'm so tired of this hyperbolic, critical,
I agree. Yeah,
enraged culture, and it seems like the internet is fueled on anger alone these days.
Yeah,
and there's very little positivity, and as a straight white male, I realize I'm coming at that from a position of privilege. I understand that.
Yeah. That's true.
And I have the privilege of receding and not being angry all the time. I get that. But what I found was it was affecting me all the time, and that is no way to live. And I think that it would behoove all of us to pull back and stay off social media and talk, just hang out, have a good time. Yeah.
Go you back know, to the dick pics.
Look,
don't put the political stuff, but the dick pics.
Only use dick pics.
Yeah.
I mean, there are so many things I hate about you, but now that I'm off the social media, I don't talk about those. You and I, we hang out, we bridge the gap. We hang out. We have a good time.
We enjoy dick pics together. Like, that's it.
Like, yeah. I don't like the fact that you like pleats. I'm a flat front man.
Yeah, true.
I am enraged by the fact that you're a pleated man.
I don't like the fact you like blue cargo shorts, and I like the planes. You know,
but somehow we're hanging out.
I hate you, but I also love you.
I know.
So it's kind of a weird thing.
I found
thing.
A way to love you because we may not agree on pleat or flat fronts or khaki or blue or dyes, color dyes.
But if we don't tweet about it, then we can get along.
Now we're bridging the gap.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's just. I'm so sick of the constantly enraged culture. I'm just tired of it, and I browse, like, I scan Twitter.
Yeah.
I just don't post anymore. And I have to roll my eyes so many times. There's so much stupid crap.
Masturbate a little bit to it,
of course.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm constantly splattering the phone. My phone is like a Jackson Pollock painting.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
I never wipe it off.
Well, that just adds to, you know.
So it just crusts over.
It's a protective layer that you add to it, yeah.
So... Kel Surprise, there was a big reaction to this article.
Can't believe it.
No way. So Sean Hill had to get on Beer Advocate, and somebody on Beer Advocate posted something in the forum about it, and I didn't
Sean
bother.
Sean Mullins also get on Beer
Advocate. Of course, all the Seans. Sean Ryan also.
Everything.
Sean Ryan from The Shield, and Sean Mullins got to get a duet.
Did Sean Bass get on there, too?
No, he's not allowed.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
It has to be an S-H-A-W-N.
Oh, okay, yeah. He's not a real person anyway. So
although Sean from Hill Farmstead is a UN guy.
Oh, okay.
But, of course, plenty of enraged people. So, no surprise.
Yeah.
And I stay off, you know, some wine, stay off beer forums as well because sick of it.
Oh, my God.
But Sean decided he wanted to come clear the air a little bit, and he said...
So to speak.
This person had asked me my thoughts about dozens of topics, speaking of the journalist, and somehow had crafted a lead that made it seem as if I had intentionally sought a soapbox from which to speak. The material... in the article he's speaking of, was less than 5% of the entire conversation, but it purported to be much more than I could have ever imagined. I certainly take issue with the light in which this article portrays my thoughts as if I am some sort of new wave prohibitionist with a puritanical self-righteousness. I was drinking half liters of Pilsner during this interview. he continues, I am made to appear that I took an interview in order to talk shit about all of my peers for being drunks and mentally ill. The quotes and leads are out of context and frankly quite frustrating. I have some, you know, issue with that. But I was asked to conduct this interview as a coordinator with my keynote speech on innovation in the brewing industry. This was a casual interview that sadly ended up with some sort of sensational headline that was a modified version of our conversation. No soapbox, just an honest look at my life, and the interview seemed, at the time, very genuinely interested in learning more about how Hill Farmstead came into existence. So
little did I know.
Okay, so if they were taken out of context, what was the context? And this is the problem I have. Everybody likes to say it's taken out of context. Okay, you're not denying you said those things.
Right.
Now, don't say taken out of context. Just say this was not the entirety of our conversation. This was not the focus of our conversation. You could have left it out of that. It was not taken out of context because you said those things, and you were right about those
things. And it was in context, yes.
Frankly, I would have respected this more if he had said, I was right about what I said.
I liked his first post better, yes.
Yes.
I agree.
Like, you can say it was not the point of our conversation. It was a very little part of our conversation. Yep. But I'm not wrong.
Well, like everything we said today, if somebody wanted to say, oh, Brewblood said this, I'd be like, yeah. We did.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's definitely critiques around consuming a lot of alcohol. There's no problem around that.
He wasn't saying that people were being drunks or being mentally ill.
Right.
Those are those people choosing to take that attitude.
Yeah.
If I'm just going off what the article says, I don't have the rest of the context.
Right.
But if I'm just going off the quotes that are in the article, he never said that people were drunks. He said, basically, people are using it as a coping mechanism to negative consequences.
Right.
And that we should all be a little more conscious of that. There's nothing wrong with that.
That's a very good argument.
And I totally
support that argument, actually.
It's a valid argument. Yeah. It's something we should all take note of and take to heart. So, you know, I have issue with his response. I think he should have just let it stand.
Yep.
I think he should have maybe just said, look, it was a small part of our interview, and he chose to make this the focus.
Right.
You know, but I'm not wrong about it. He's like, you know, nothing wrong with that.
He's also speaking
to his own issues.
Yep.
He was speaking for himself also.
Right, yes.
He wasn't just like pointing the finger, you know?
Yep.
It's frustrating.
I totally agree. Yep.
So all this mental health issue aside, we're going to talk about BrewDog's Nanny State today.
In fact, I think it kind of goes to the point.
It does.
This is a very low ABV beer.
Very low ABV.
And maybe like the way the industry is trending. And it's like low ABV beers are supposed to be the new hotness.
Yep. And we're going to get very critical and point many fingers after this.
Yes.
Hey guys, it's Nate. Maybe you remember me from my old podcast, The Hobo Shack. I'm back. I've got a new show. It's called The Cult of Personality, and it's on Radio Diabolus. Every Friday night from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, I'll be playing music, doing some interviews, and some other random If you missed The Hobo Shack, this is the next best thing. Come listen on Radio Diabolus. That's radio-diabolus.eu. You can follow the show on Facebook at Cult of Personality. That's KVLT of Personality. Or you can shoot me an email at cultofpersonality@gmail.com. Come spend your Friday nights with me on Radio Diabolus in the Cult of Personality. I'm back. I hope you guys are too. And you ain't getting my best.
So are you someone who typically goes for low to non-ABV beers?
You know, it depends kind of on the day. Like, sometimes yes, sometimes no.
Because I don't. I mean, as we've been talking about, I haven't been drinking as much. So when I do get the chance to drink, I'm drinking something that's going to be kind of fairly high octane.
But you know, like, if we're going to have like a pool day and it's 95 degrees outside, I actually like, you know, for example, the Easy Peasy IPA from Deep Ellum or something like that. Like,
right.
I like the 3 to 4% stuff.
Okay, but I'm talking
it's kind of nice.
I'm talking the what are considered non-alcoholic beers. Do you ever go for those? You're
not,
Rolling Rocks.
Not too
Rolling
much.
Rocks was it, isn't that a non?
Well, I mean, like what is it? Caliber? I can't remember. There's a few that are like
I guess
stouts
Rolling Rock.
And
Rolling Rock isn't. Anyways,
That's a regular beer. Yes, it's low ABV, but yes, it's regular. But yeah, like the I think it's Caliber, and there's a couple other ones that have like no ABV.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'd be okay with that on occasion if it actually tasted good. I think the U.S. has a real problem with actually having decent tasting low ABV to no ABV beers. They usually taste like crap.
That's true.
Let's just be honest, yeah.
And frankly, when people, as we've been talking about, people want to get effed up.
Yeah.
They want to get altered, go a little sideways.
I will say for me, though, like I actually like the taste of beers, unlike you, even though we're both on beer podcast. So if there is a nice tasting beer that had no ABV, I'd actually be okay with that because
I
would
like
to taste it.
I like the taste of beer. I don't like the taste of crap beer.
Yeah,
like I'm not going to drink non-alcoholic beer just to have it.
Just giving you a hard time, just kicking you in the proverbial nuts, you know.
If
all, literal, yes.
If a non-alcoholic beer tasted like a KBS or something,
yeah.
Then I would drink it. It's just that, no, they
don't.
That's
what I'm thinking of, yes. Like, that's why I've always wanted this one, and I'm very excited about the one today because I saw you cannot get this in the U.S.,
mm-hmm.
We fortunately have, you know, Mike's Sick and Mike that, you know, stuck it up Kit's ass and
right.
Sent it back over here to the Americas. And we're actually able to try the one low to no ABV beer that I've wanted to try for a long time. It's probably been a couple years at this point.
And that's the BrewDog Nanny State we're talking about. Now,
yes.
This one in particular, they have it's in a half percent alcohol, 0.5 ABV.
Yeah.
It has gone as high as the high octane 1.1%. And previously, has an IBU of 45. And it's interesting, Beer Advocate puts this in the non-alcoholic beer category, but technically it's a pale ale.
Right.
It's a West Coast-inspired pale ale, but it's not an IPA.
This was a Kit Anus beer, right?
It was a Kit Anus beer, yes.
Okay, just making sure.
I pulled it fresh out of his butt today.
Yeah. Okay, just making sure how fresh it was, yeah.
So the description for this beer, it's written really weird. I thought maybe just some Untappd user added it, but I think this is an official BrewDog because I saw it multiple places. Description. And this time, it is all about the beer, and the beer is awesome. Gone are the 200-plus IBU, which brought grown men to tears. Our new Nanny State is 0.5% ABV and focuses on being a great drink as opposed to a great publicity ploy. The beer is now focused, with two S's, on getting all that is good about BrewDog into a practically alcohol-free format. It's a West Coast-inspired pale ale with a difference. Another exclamation point. The beer has
a difference,
40,
okay.
The beer has 45 IBUs and is brewed with Centennial, Amarillo, Columbus, Cascade, and Simcoe hops, and intensively dry-hopped with Centennial and Amarillo. The backbone is provided by 8 different types of specialty malts with, whatever, you don't care about that.
Yeah.
Let's see, yes, Nanny State will tantalize your taste buds and leave you yearning for more. Now, this is not a well-rated beer.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, it's on Beer Advocate. It only has 49 ratings. On Beer Advocate, it gets a 3.12 out of 5. Only 49 ratings. Ray Beer gets a 25 overall.
Wow.
But 95 in style. I'm guessing
like that, is the style no ABV?
I think so, if I remember right, yeah. I forgot to note that, but that's quite the... I think that's maybe the biggest disparity we've ever seen between overall and style.
I would agree, yes.
And Untappd gives it a 2.78 out of 5 with over 30,000 unique reviews.
Wow.
Okay. So it is not well rated.
That's unfortunate because amongst the no ABV beers, it always seemed to be one of the higher ones.
Okay, so the overall impression of a pale ale, which is what we're going to go with, since it's supposed to be a non-alcoholic pale ale, is that it should be refreshing and hoppy, yet with sufficient supporting malt. And as they said in the description, they use 8 different backing malts. So that's a sufficient amount of malt. So the aroma on this beer... So you, first of all, we should say, what are you expecting for this beer? Are you expecting... I mean, given the low ratings we've already talked about...
Well, I would still expect like the profile to be somewhat like a... I don't know, like a Sierra Nevada Pale Ale, something like that, you know?
That's fair.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of the profile of like a Pale Ale, like very generic, standard Pale Ale. That's what I would hope for, yes.
Yeah, I'm surprised that, just based on ratings, I would expect more out of BrewDog.
Yeah, me too, yeah.
But we shall see. So the aroma of a Pale Ale, this is an American Pale Ale, I should say, not an English Pale Ale. The aroma should be usually moderate to strong hop aroma, sometimes citrusy or fruity.
It's moderate. It's a little bit citrusy.
It's kind of, it's a, like, if you really stick your schnoz in there,
yeah,
it's a little dank, actually.
Yeah, but I would say moderately.
It's moderately. Not, it's not overpowering.
Overwhelming, yeah.
It's not like a dank bomb.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely not.
You're not using one of those volcano vaporizer things.
Right.
It's not quite that.
Yeah.
But it's a little grassy, a little earthy.
Grassy, yeah.
A little hempy.
Yep.
Kind of smells like someone that, I don't know, like weed jeans or something. Got a little weed smoke in your jeans, something like that.
True, yeah.
The
Looks like your undies after you, you know, smoke a lot, yeah.
I only smoke with
and then you throw it in my face, yeah.
The appearance should be pale golden to deep amber with a moderately large to off-white head with good retention.
It's definitely amber.
It is definitely an amber.
Yeah,
for sure. It is. It's like a, it's a good bronze color. It's like a reddish,
bronze. Amber, rusty.
It's like a dark bronze.
Yeah, it's like a rusty color.
Rusty, yeah.
Yeah.
And I would say head retention is pretty good for this beer.
Yeah, I would agree. Yeah.
And it is like lightly white. Lightly tan.
Yes.
Now, the most important, of course, is flavor and mouthfeel. Nah. Usually a moderate to
Not
high hop flavor. Low to moderately high clean malt character supports the hop presentation and may show small amounts of specialty malt character of bread, toast, or biscuits, and mouthfeel should be medium light to medium body, carbonation moderate to high, and a smooth finish without astringency.
So carbonation's high. Hop flavor is fairly high, but there is an extreme, extreme bitter back end on this thing. Like, it tastes like the most bitter of bitters that you can possibly ever find in your entire life.
This is really soapy.
Yeah, it's soapy and bitter. Do you feel the bitter, too? Like, am I out
it's
on that?
Bitter, but not in a pleasant way. Oh, ho.
No, no, I don't mean in a pleasant way. It's bad bitter. It's, like, nasty.
It's getting worse. The more it just sits in my mouth.
Yeah, that's so unfortunate, because I was really hoping that BrewDog would get a low ABV beer right, but...
And I realize it's probably a real challenge to try to make a flavorful...
Sure, yeah.
...non-alcoholic beer. But I don't think this is a high watermark by any stretch.
Man, yeah, that really kicks the back of the palate hard. Ugh. And it's really, like you said, it's kind of like, you know, if you cursed and your mama stuck like a bar of soap in your face.
It's like a Christmas story when Ralphie.
That's very much like the Ralphie Christmas story soap incident. Yeah. That's what that is. I mean, it's not good. It's very bitter. It's very soapy. Very just generally unpleasant.
It's generally
it really kind of hurts my tongue. Like, it's,
I won't go that far, but as far as hurting tongue, but...
My tongue is angry. I'll put it that way.
I think the only thing I enjoy about this beer is the carbonation.
Carbonation is good.
I think it's pleasantly carbonated. Like, it's light and crisp, and it's very well carbonated, but that's all I can say about it.
This makes me very happy that I did not request a case of this from Mike, Steph, and Mike to send to me, because I considered doing that, because it was like, oh, this will be a good non-alcoholic beer I could try over here. But I'm like,
this is punishment, and not in that fun 50 Shades way.
Man, this is not sweating your ass in a pleasant way. This is this is swatting your ass and causing bruising and extremely deep gashes. I mean, this is not good. I hate that too, man. I was really hoping this would be good.
I know. I'm so disappointed. I had high expectation.
I like BrewDog. A lot of stuff they do.
Am I wrong?
Man, it's like eating earwax or something.
It's like dish soapy, right?
It's dish soap, earwax, bitter. The carbonation, like you said, is good, but that doesn't save it. You know,
Again, this is another option. This is why I would never go for non-alcoholic beer, because I might even say that this is worse than other examples I've had.
I'd rather have Caliber Stout. I mean, that's better than this.
I would never drink this under any circumstance.
Some of the U.S. options are actually way better than this, I'll be honest.
Oh, man.
And this is not... They're not great, but the U.S. options are better by far than this. Like,
and that
this
ain't
is,
saying much.
This is hurting. This is painful. This is painful beer.
This is lemon cruller bad.
Yeah. I think if you dug your finger in your ear and tasted it, it'd be like this.
I think this might be worse than lemon cruller. This is a... And I don't
it's
like
really
to say
bad.
I don't like to say this. This is a drain pour beer.
It's really bad. It's really, really bad. I mean, it's trying to be hoppy. It's trying to be bitter.
I don't like to use the words drain pour, but this is bad.
Yeah, it's not working at all. It's really bad.
The only thing that's got going for it for me is the carbonation. I'd really like this level of carbonation. I wish more beers had that.
And you know, I'm trying not to taint it with high expectations, being BrewDog and being a low ABV beer, but I don't think that's what it is. I think it's just bad. I don't think it's me trying to hype it up. I just think it's nasty.
I think I might have rather had the 1.1% ABV with the absurd hop character. If it had some absurd IBU, I think I might enjoy that more.
Yeah.
As it is, I wonder if the lower IBU here is giving it that soapy quality.
It might. I don't know what's doing it, but man.
It is not working.
Like you said, soapy, bitter. You know, and I love piney. I love double IPAs. That's not what's hurting it. It can be as piney as hell, and I would love it. But it's something about the fact that it's piney and bitter that just kind of taints it in a weird way.
It really tastes weird.
Yeah, it's kind of thin.
I understand it's non-alcoholic. It's probably going to be thin. I'm a little more forgiving on that respect, but the taste is just bad.
The thin's fine. Like, it's not the thickness that bothers me. It's the bitter, just kill my palate taste that I'm not a fan of.
Yeah. I am really disappointed by this beer.
Yeah, I agree.
So, ratings.
Man, for me...
I think that says it all.
I had
an
such
exasperated sigh.
Yeah, I had such high hopes, and now I have such low hopes. Well, not hopes. I've already tasted it, so...
Yeah.
Such low results. I gotta say, like, the hope versus actual what occurred factor, if that's even a thing, I was hoping for, like, 1,000 thumbs up, and what I got was, like, 5,000 thumbs down.
Yeah.
And so I'm gonna say, too bitter, too nasty. Oh, my gosh. I really have to give it, like, 45 thumbs down. I wouldn't recommend it. I would say if you're gonna get something, get one of the domestic non-ABV beers. They are better, especially the stouts. And some of the... There's even one that's kind of like a slightly hoppy that's a domestic. I think it's another Caliber beer. I'd go that way over this because don't pay the international shipping costs. It's not worth it. Even though it's BrewDog, who has a name. Gotta say, 45 thumbs down.
I am severely disappointed by this beer. I expected more out of BrewDog. This, honestly... This formula, I am more forgiving of smaller breweries when they don't dump a beer because it really affects their bottom line if they make a bunch and it doesn't work.
Yep.
BrewDog has enough money that this should not have made it out of. I'm sorry, this should not have made it out of the first batch. This is just not good.
Yeah.
It's not even just disappointing. It's just not good.
Yeah.
I love BrewDog. I think I've loved every beer I've had of theirs, just about.
Yeah.
This is the first beer I've ever been disappointed by them and severely disappointed at that. I expected so much more out of them. I applaud them for trying it.
Yeah, me too.
But there's a big difference between trying and releasing. And this is, I mean, this is so dish soapy. I just can't do
it's
this.
It's like drinking a vat of Dawn.
It's really not. Yeah. It's very, I don't know if it's.
Not that I've done that, but I'm assuming this is what it would taste like if you did do that.
It's very dish soapy. It's very, yeah, it's like Dawn. It's, I am just, I'm mad. I'm getting to the point where I'm mad about this beer. Yeah. And I think this might be more disappointing than the Lemon Cruller, and that's saying something. So
that had no expectations. For me, I was looking for low ABV beers. This one was rated one of the top ones. And I'm like, I don't know how that happened. After tasting it.
Maybe that was the 1.1% one. Maybe that one was better.
Maybe.
But I expected more out of BrewDog.
Yeah.
I'm glad we don't get this in the United States.
Yeah.
Because I would smash.
Don't even ship it over here.
Just don't even bother. It's not worth your time.
No.
Honestly, just go grab an O'Doul's or something.
Yes.
Just drink some water. Have a nice, refreshing cup of water.
Have a fruit juice. Have something else. Exactly. It'll all be better than this.
Have a nice cran grape or something.
Yes.
Just don't waste your time. It's not even worth it. Man, I have no choice but to give this, 203 thumbs down.
Yes.
This is my least favorite beer we've ever done on the show.
Wow. Yeah, it's definitely down there for me, too. I don't remember Lemon Cruller well enough, but this gives it a run. I'll admit that.
It's just,
it's bad. Don't drink it. Don't drink Nanny State.
And we're not.
No Nanny State.
Just ignore. No nannies. Yeah. No nannies.
Go for the Tokyo. Don't go for the Nanny State. Go
the other ABV.
Don't go for the Nun.
I'm so
sad.
Sad.
So sad.
Thanks for listening to yet another episode of Brew Bloods. If you're not subscribed to the show, you should be. It's absolutely free, and you can subscribe anywhere fine podcasts can be found. Through Apple Podcasts, Google Music, Spotify, or any podcast app out there. Above all, please tell a friend about us. We'd really appreciate it. If you want to reach out to us, you can find us as at Brew Bloods on all the social networks, or email us at brewbloodsshow@gmail.com. That's brewbloodsshow@gmail.com. So for everyone here at Brew Bloods, this is Mark saying Prost.